Good morning, Revolution, and happy Thanksgiving. Hello, hello, everybody. Scott and Anita, good morning. How are you?
Good morning. Very well. How are you, Joe?
Hey, man, I'm okay. I'm alive. I'm kicking.
That's
and,
good.
I survived Thanksgiving, and it has been quite a week. Quite a week. Unemployment up.
Mm-hmm.
And what else? COVID rate up. 2,000 people are dying a day.
Joe, you had a terrific article on that that you published a couple of days ago, right? That ended with the stock market keeps going up, 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 but food lines are getting longer and longer, and it's time our patience got a lot shorter. I really love that line.
Patients got shorter. You know that's right. But why isn't it getting shorter? I mean, people, or maybe it is, and we just don't see it. Anita?
The food lines are going to get even longer, I understand, because, and a lot of funding for various programs runs out on the 31st of December. So I think
unemployment going to be gone.
That's right. That's right. And a lot of funding for food banks and things like that. A lot of things run out in 31st of December. And the Senate seems completely uninterested in passing any kind of a stimulus bill.
And they're still holding hard and fast on this idea that employers have to be fully protected from any liability for people getting sick in their workplaces. That's the thing the Republicans have been that's been the big stalling point for any, and you know that's a big deal because I was reading about one workplace, a Tyson Foods chicken processing plant, where not only were they telling people to come to work sick and giving them bonuses for coming to work sick, supervisors were actually betting on the number of workers who are going to get coronavirus. Just the level of cynicism and sort of heartlessness involved in this is ridiculous.
That's capitalism.
I heard of a similar case of one of those medical clinics in Washington State that's going on strike, actually. The management, and it's kind of retail medicine is what they call it. And they didn't want the customers to be scared. So they forbade their doctors from wearing N95 masks. And they're organized now, and it's just being a doctor is no longer the kind of profession it is. It's just another working class job. But they're organized and they're fighting.
That's great. Good to hear that they're organizing.
Sounds like it's grounds for a suit. I mean, and a big one. But you know, is it really the Senate went home? I mean, isn't it that McConnell and them, the Republicans, blocked every single effort to passed the what was it called, the Heroes Act.
Yeah, it wasn't just, I mean, it wasn't Sherrod Brown, for example. It was definitely Mitch McConnell who sent the Senate home, basically, without taking care of that piece of business. So McConnell had much power over that body.
There's a big race coming up in Georgia in a couple of weeks, so we'll see what happens with that. But I wanted to ask a question. The Senate is looks like it might be split, and the House, the Democratic Party, lost some seats, but it still has a majority. I've heard it said a lot of times on the news, and I read it in a newspaper, that this is a symbolizes the fact that the American people decided on mixed government. Think about that proposition. Is that true? The American people, did the collective consciousness of the American board people come in and decide that we should have a split government? Is that?
That sounds like a capitalist fantasy to me, because that's the ideal situation for them. That's the ideal situation for the ruling class, because you know they have that bourgeois democratic section that favors kind of multilateral compromise, whatever, for the stability of the class. But you also, facing crisis, have the kind of far right in reserve with all of the incredibly vicious, incredibly reactionary policies that will enable them to to keep profits flowing. So yes, the ruling class is split, but their interest, I think, is manifested in a government where, where the two sections of the ruling class quibble over little things rather than one that's under the kind of decisive influence of the people.
Mm-hmm. I would add that the makeup of the legislature really doesn't reflect the will of the people either, because it's, first of all, there's so much gerrymandering, even though half of Ohioans vote for the Democrats, 2/3 of the seats go to the Republicans. And in the bigger picture, in Wyoming, one senator represents like 700 people or something. And in California, it's like hundreds of thousands of people are represented by one person. So it's really not fair. It's not the will of the people reflected there anyway.
There's another idea that's runs right alongside the one that about the American people deciding on split government. And that is the notion that the system was under stress, but the democratic institutions, folks, are working. I mean, they're working. Fascism isn't here. Democracy prevailed. Scott, you're shaking your head. You don't agree?
Well, I'm thinking that what we saw was not, Trump was not this uniquely malignant creature that put this huge stress. I mean, what stresses democracy, what the obstacle to democracy is still there. It's, it's white supremacy, it's patriarchy, it's ultimately capitalism. Those things are still in there. And until we take meaningful strides to, I've been saying for a while, we actually need to defeat the far right, not just, break the Republican majority in the Senate or whatever, but dismantle the set of institutions and think tanks and policy centers and propaganda network and everything that is enabling the far right to punch above its kind of democratic weight.
Mm-hmm. At the risk of being always the glass half full person here, I have to say the courts, I was happy to see the courts throw out, I think 25 of 26 challenges or something that the Trump administration trumped up against the election. So at least that was going, that was.
But those were the lower courts, weren't they? True. And now there was a court in Pennsylvania, which yesterday or the day before put a stay on the vote certification, and now the governor of Pennsylvania is appealing to the Supreme Court. The same Supreme Court, by the way, that yesterday decided that religious institutions have priority over state governments when it comes to health measures.
But is he appealing to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court or to the national Supreme Court? Those are very different bodies politically.
I think to the national Supreme Court.
I don't know.
I'm not sure.
The case, the stay was given by the Commonwealth Court of Pennsylvania, so I'm not sure what the next appellate step there is. But yeah, if it's the national Supreme Court, it's going to go badly.
But the Pennsylvania Supreme Court is dominated by Democrats, I think.
Yeah.
It's dominated by, because, so that's one of the things that, the news, guys, the news, I was watching the news, there was no news on the news. I was trying to prepare for the program this morning and there was no freaking news on the news, which, so one of the things that all of these court decisions are taking place by, not all of them, but a lot of them by lower court. And then the strategy of the Republicans is to appeal.
Yeah.
Is to appeal. And, but none of these, constitutional law experts that I ever talk about that is, we won, everything is in la la land, Biden is going to be, and they never share with the people what's really taking place. Mm. Is that,
because they don't understand what's taking place. They don't, we have, I mean, this
what
is
What do you mean they don't understand what's taking place? They run the goddamn thing.
Well, but they, I mean, the same way a lot of the bourgeois economists didn't understand what was happening in 2008. You understanding isn't just being able to look in a clear way at things. You have to have, it requires a set of kind of methodological assumptions and a way of looking at things. And, you know, there are people who know the history of constitutional law in the US top to bottom, but if you don't have, you know, a class way of looking at it, if you don't have a real understanding of democracy, if your understanding of democracy is that it's a checklist, and as long as you have three functioning branches, then you're fine. Then you
constitutional lawyers who make arguments before the Supreme Court, who go on MSNBC and CNN and NBC and all the, and they don't know that with respect to the laws of the United States, that the cases decided by lower courts are going to be appealed, then all of
it doesn't occur to them to ask the question, right? It doesn't unless you're capable of framing the question in a certain way, then you're not going to see that.
Oh my goodness. It makes me want to just, you know.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen, Anita? Is Biden going to get inaugurated? Trump by
oath? Oh, hell yes.
This is another thing. It was news this morning, Anita, that, Trump says he's going to leave the White House.
Right. Of course he was. He would be taken out if he wasn't going out. So, I think he will, and I think he'll probably snub the inauguration, which would be fine. We don't need to see him there. So
he's going to have a bigger, better de-inauguration somewhere else.
Yes,
a counter inauguration, like the president in exile. Maybe like, you know, move to Texas or some place. And sorry, Texas, I love you, but you know, you're a big state, and
yeah, unfortunately, Florida will get him. I think, you know,
let him have it. I'm done with Florida.
Anita, long as he don't come to Ohio. Stay there, Sam. Come out of Ohio. I don't want none of you in Ohio. But, you know, this, and that's assuming that the Supreme Court or another appellate court that's stacked with these right-wing judges doesn't do something, which makes me very nervous about.
Right.
I still don't accept that there are no hurdles to overcome between now and the inauguration. Even though last week there was a significant shift in the ruling class with respect to Trump's refusal to do the right thing. The business community, big capital in New York, 200 or so of them, sent a letter saying, yo, man, you gotta stop acting stupid, you know? And after that, the legal team, Giuliani and that crazy woman from Texas who was defending Oliver North, and they were making all of these crazy allegations. But Scott, were they crazy like a fox?
Because I think it's hard to say.
Because their appeal with respect to Hugo Chavez and the voting machines and China and the software, they're not trying to convince the American people, are they, Scott?
So I think there's been this ongoing kind of debate for the entire Trump administration. Is what they're doing a distraction, or is it a real attempt at something? And I think that's not how they work strategically. They do things that are, remember when the big buzzword of capitalism was disrupt, right? They do things to disrupt, and then they see what the fallout is because they know that they're in the best position to take advantage of those sorts of things, right? So they're throwing everything they can at this, and they're hoping that something's gonna jump off that will enable them to hold on to power for a little bit longer. But if it doesn't, there's plausible deniability. We're just crazy, you know, we're crackpots. It was just entertainment, like they say on Fox News.
Anita, I have another theory. That's the throw it at the wall, see what sticks.
See what explodes.
And it's a plausible But Anita, I have another theory.
Okay.
My theory is that they're using anti-communism, Hugo Chavez, China, to rile up the Republican base. They're not appealing to you and me or to the average Joe or Jane and Columbus.
Right.
They're appealing to their right-wing base, trying to rile them up so that they can put pressure on the state legislatures so that they can overturn and throw the election into the House of Representatives. What do you think?
I would put money on the idea that that's not going to happen. I really don't think they're going to be successful at doing that. But I think what they do want to do is rile up the base and keep them riled up, so that Trump can continue to milk that 70 million people for rally tickets and so forth, and just more mischief over the next 4 years and possibly a rerun in 24. So we'll see. But he wants to keep the base united and pissed off. And that's causing a little problem in Georgia, by the way, because the Kelly Loeffler and whatever the other one's name is, were challenged. Like, why aren't you doing enough to challenge the voter fraud in Georgia? Trump supporters are calling on them to do something. So it's an interesting situation in Georgia.
And I see that some people in MAGMA world are saying, oh, we should just boycott the whole damn thing. It's
not go ahead and do it. Do it.
Please boycott.
Take a lesson from the trots. Take a lesson Maoists. Please do it.
Yes.
It's bourgeois. It's capitalist. It's unfair. The one world government is dominating it, and you can't do anything about it. Zog is dominating it. Oh my God!
Right.
To another topic, last week the Biden administration has put forward a number of nominees for State Department, for the Treasury. Are you excited, Anita? Waking up with a smile on your face every day.
I'm not super excited about it, but I think it gives a lie to the idea that Biden is going to usher in socialism. And I think that's maybe something that we can keep going at least until, we want Georgia voters to not have that. And I heard someone say about Biden, it was an interesting idea, that Biden makes everything seem normal and boring. And so he can have a very progressive global energy, global climate change policy, and it seems normal and mediocre, middle of the road, not radical. So I think it will be interesting to see. I think he's just playing it very carefully. And I don't see anything really so objectionable yet, but I think we just have to keep an eye on it.
Well, there are a lot of undersecretaries in the various departments who, from the Obama administration, Scott, who are now going to be the secretaries of defense, treasury. You got Ms. Yellen coming back, secretary.
Yeah, you can do worse than Janet Yellen.
Right.
They say she's a neo-Keynesian in favor of addressing.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like it's going to be Obama rerun, Scott. I mean, and is that a good thing or a bad thing? And
let me rephrase
the question. Is the reassertion of U.S. imperial foreign policy, multilateralism, NATO, strategic competition, let's beat up on China, a good thing? Let's continue to isolate Venezuela.
It's a horrible thing. It's all of the the swamp of Obama era and Bush era and previous foreign policies. It's ridiculous. But what we have to keep in mind is that the ruling class has done such a good job of isolating foreign policy from Democratic pressure, that it's going to take a much bigger, much stronger movement to be able to change the fundamental basis of US foreign policy through an election. I mean, Obama ran promising to do that, and what we got was drones instead of boots on the ground.
And the Obama administration beat up on Cuba for most of its time until the very end, and then let up. So
and
I think Cuba is looking at this as a positive thing, you know, for to relieve their the problems there from the embargo, for example. There's a possibility of overturning that now.
That would be
huge. That would be wonderful. That would be something to celebrate.
Exactly.
But we'll see. I think, again, we keep saying this, that the main thing now is to keep the pressure on, to keep the people as much as possible, you know, activated. Is that a word? Activated, active,
in the streets? I don't like it. It feels like, it makes us sound like machines.
You don't like active?
Or viruses.
Mobilized
in the street. You know, optimistic, but realistic.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that coming up, you know, we have Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday, which will be a day of struggle and a celebration. We'll have to get ready for the inauguration and the Communist Party's reply to it. And then the State of the Union coming up during Black History Month. And hunger in the course of this is increasing. Joblessness increasing. COVID increasing.
Homelessness too.
Homelessness increasing.
You know, they're just so insistent on replaying the Obama administration that they're starting off with the worst crisis in, you know, in 80 years, just like Obama did.
That's right.
And it's going to take a whole lot to solve the crisis. I would like to see us do a program on U.S. foreign policy coming up. I think that will be very important. Sometimes we forget how the world sees this country.
Mm-hmm.
How the world doesn't understand that, because all of them feel the brunt of the boot of U.S. imperialism in Africa, Asia, Latin America, Europe, and they don't really, and sometimes we don't see it because we don't experience it directly unless we have a son or a daughter or a brother, a sister, a neighbor who was fighting overseas. So it's going to be important for us to, you know, get a handle on that going forward as well. But nevertheless, we are living in the beginning of a new period. You know, if this was midnight, it would be like 12:01 after the defeat of the Trump administration. And a lot can happen, a lot has to happen. And you can be guaranteed that the Communist Party is gonna be right in the middle of it, fighting for the working classes and people's interests. So until next week, Anita, you know, take it easy.
Enjoy the rest of Thanksgiving weekend.
Yeah, digest that food. We'll be back next Friday, same time, same station, and YouTube and Facebook world, guys. Stay safe, stay strong, stay physically distant, but socially close.